Welcome to Let's Play coremud. My name is Gray. I am the creator of coremud, and I'm just gonna go ahead and launch right into the game. And just as a little bit of a preview here, or a little bit of background, MUDs are very old technology, and they predate MMOs by several years. Obviously, it's a text-based game. Today, I'm going to play it old school, and I'm just going to use a Telnet client. In this case, I'm using PuTTY. It's a free download. Just Google it, P-U-T-T-Y, and the first link that you get back on Google is the correct one. When you launch it, it'll open up this screen right here. We just type coremud.org. We change the port to be 4000, and this is regular Telnet. You can save the session if you like, so you can pull back up again. And you really don't need to mess around with any of the other settings today. Okay, so that has come up. Now let me bring this window into Twitch, because for some reason it's not streaming correctly. So let me hide that, and let's create a new window here. New window capture. And that, there we go, that's what we want to see. So we'll save that, and let's make this so that everybody can see it. And we need to see if I can't make this guy, we're going to make our screen a little bit longer. No, we're not doing click jacking, thank you very much. Let's make this a little bit longer so it'll fit nicely into the Twitch stream there. Okay, let's see how that works. Okay, so this is our login screen, and this is pretty common for MUD to have a kind of like a little splash screen that kind of gives you a little bit of information about the website that is hosting the game. And then, of course, if you need to contact the administrator, some will also list that information, a little blurb about what the game is. In this case, it's a science fiction MUD. Most of the MUDs out there in the internet, the ones that are still around, are more fantasy based. I completely ripped that out and rewrote a lot of the mechanics of the game from scratch. I'm going to create a new character here, and so we type new because that's what it tells us to do. And I'm going to create an account called Twitch, and hopefully it's not taken. And it is not valid, so we'll call it, let's try Core Twitch. Not a valid name, okay. I must have a filter. Alright, so we will call this guy, we gotta come up with some kind of a name here. This is probably the hardest part of playing, is coming up with a name that passes the goofy little restrictions that we have here. So, and there are certain words, or actually there are certain character sequences that are not allowed to be part of the game. So for example, I can't have any name that has fuck in it. That's a no-no. That'll be, in fact, it just says, nah, you're gone. So now I need to go ahead and open up another PuTTY session. So let me get back in here. And let me get this guy captured as part of the Twitch stream. Okay, very good. So, cool. It came up. All right. So, we'll go new. And, all right. So, I'm going to be nice guy. And now we have our character naming policy. So, that passed the test. So, here we can... it's basically saying, don't be a trademark name. Don't be a jerk. Don't be Captain Kirk or Gandalf or Neo. Right now we're set to one character per IP. We really don't like to have multiple characters on here. Part of that was that on the server that we're using, we are limited to a certain number of connections. So and it's really easy that you could cheat if you had multiple characters. So right now we restrict it to one character per real life person. That may change in the future, but for right now that's the policy. So I'm going to say yes, that is my name. I could be, now if I want to pick something different just to show how it works, I hit no, I hit enter, and I say okay, who do you really want to be? We'll call it, can I be Robo Guy? Okay. Yes. Okay. Now I have to pick my password. Here you can see, back when this was, I probably need to update this. Right now it's 5 letters. This is really before brute force password hacking really came to the forefront. So I'm going to go ahead and create my password now. And I'm typing it, and we cannot see. Uppercase, lowercase, numbers, and special characters are all acceptable. And now, how do you want my name to be capitalized? So here, you can notice when I created my character, the true name is going to be lowercase. So anytime the game wants to refer to my character under the covers, and we'll have a future stream, if I don't get burned at the stake for this terrible one, the game will always refer to us as our lowercase name. However, there is a capitalized name that we can pick that other players will see, and this will be kind of our display name, if you will. So here, I'm going to go Robo Guy, and I could have spaces and hyphens and apostrophes in this capitalized name, and we do not like to see this kind of garbage. So kind of keep the capitalization meaningful. Oops, and it looks like I exceeded a timeout, so I gotta try this one more time, so forgive me. Looks like there is a timeout when you're in the login session. So you get a few minutes, and then it will think that your session timed out if you weren't able to get through all this. So new Robo Guy. Yes, I want to be Robo Guy. Put my password. I'll do my preferred capitalization. And yes, Putty is capable of showing ANSI colors. So I hit yes. Here we need to put in an email address. Now, I don't spam the players. In fact, I think since the year 2000, I think I've sent maybe 2 emails to everybody just advising of a server name change. So we do need the email account stored so that if you ever request a password reset in the future, that I can, otherwise I won't be able to know who you are. And if you submit a password request to me, I won't be able to look you up. So put in your name. If you want to be anonymous, you don't have to put in your real name. It does help with a password reset request, so if you give me your actual name, I will be able to look that up. Only the game administrators will be able to see this information, the email address and the name that you give. Okay, the in-game character gender is for role-playing purposes only. I'm going to be a male. And how did you find the mud? I made it. All right, so if you found the core through a search engine or a listing somewhere, or even this stream, then it's just helpful to know. It logs it in a little file. We check it from time to time so that we know what's effective in getting the word out about the game. So now I'm in the game, and I will not be kicked out now from there is an idle timeout, but now that I've passed through the login process, now my idle timeout is much greater. So now I get, I'd have to look it up. It's like, I think an hour, before it kicks you off, of sitting idle. When you log on, it'll always show the news if there's any new entries that you've never seen before. So we get the general news, and then you won't see it again unless I update it. The time is shown, in the game time. So the game is a certain number of years in the future, and it does actually roll. So when we roll the year and we get to January 1st, the year will automatically change. Hit enter. We can see here we were issued a portable comm unit, which we'll get into in a minute here. And new player news. You'll see this one time. You'll never see this again. So here just tells us that we do actually have all of our help files are online. There is an in-game help command, but the in-game help command actually links to our wiki that's on the web. So it's possible to actually, you know, people who want to help out can actually update the wiki and update any article that is severely out of date, which is probably the case. So, and then of course our website. Enter. Okay. We are in the we're in the starport, and this little room here doesn't have any exits, and it requires us to. This basically, since we're a text game, it requires that you be able to read English. So, and this game is not going to be localized in any other languages, so sorry. It's a free game, so sue me. All right, this we're in the race picking room. So we can read the list. And by the way, so the bolding and the red, all of that is possible because back when I created my character, I said that that we were able to do ANSI color. So because I picked ANSI color option yes, the game says, okay, this guy can see color, so I'm going to send him the color code. So the red, the bold, other types of things are going to happen automatically for us now. All right, we're going to go ahead and we're going to read the list of races that are available. For each one of these races, I can get a help on it. So if I don't know what a Artrid is, I can go help Artrid, and it connects to the wiki, and it pulls up the article about Artrid. So for each race, there will be a little kind of a, like a role-playing description on what the race does. For most cases, the race that you pick is more kind of a role-playing thing. So most of the races are alien races, with the exception of human. When you are in this screen here and you see more, you can hit enter or you can hit Q to get out. Okay. The Artrid is a special character. Artrid is it's actually a race that used to exist in the prior version of the game. And I brought it back for our most senior players. So when you hit the level cap, you will be issued an Artrid code that will allow you to create a second character. And this is the exception to the rule about multiple characters. So when you hit the level cap, you can create an Artrid. This guy is a little bit overpowered because it has extra limbs. Artrid has four limbs, limbs that can wield weapons instead of the typical two. Otherwise, now by the way, I'm hitting the hit the up arrow key. In regular old PuTTY, it's just going to not figure it out. In a future stream, we'll use a MUD client, which is a much nicer experience to play the game. So, because it has a history, and you can hit the up arrow key, and it'll actually do what you want it to do. So, I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to make a cyborg character, a Nympho. I made it as a joke back in the day. And you have to be, your in-game character has to be female in order to play that race. Why? Because I was a pervert when I wrote this back in my 20s. So, we're going to. Now, if you forget the room that you're in, you can type look, or look here, or you can just type L. And that will make you look at your surroundings and will redisplay the description of the room. So again, this is a text-based game. The descriptions of the rooms can be very important. It can give you clues as to what you can do in the room. So now I'm going to pick. I'll be cyborg. So that'll be my race. And now it is. Now I'm in the game proper. So I've left the race-picking room, and now I'm in a room that actually has an exit. And I have received my first quest. So let's first see. I've rolled my stats. That happens automatically. I can't remember if we can do that in here or not. Yeah. So Your stats are generated automatically, and in this game, the stats do matter. Just about all of them have some kind of impact. Oh, I am one ugly dude. It shows you your... the second number is the base number, and the first one is the adjusted. You won't really need to worry about your adjusted stat until you hit the level cap. For now, as we're leveling up, our adjusted stat will be the same as our base stat. There are certain things that could be done to boost your stats, which we'll get into later. So that's the first thing. So we rolled our stats. We can see that we can run the stats command anytime. We got 4,000 starting credits. So credits is the unit of currency in this game. Just to give you a little bit of a role-playing background as to the environment that we're in. We've just taken a shuttle to what is called Core, which is the name of the planet. There's actually a more official name for it, but everybody who lives here just calls it Core. Everybody is an employee of the company. The company is some big space mega corporation that has an exclusive monopoly on this planet Core. Think of it as the Old West mining towns, where the mining town would be owned by a company, and they had basically a monopoly. They had a company store, company housing, and it was, you were almost slave labor. So that's kind of the case here. This kind of draws on the Alien series of movies, and also the Sean Connery movie in the 80s called Outland. Might want to take a look at that. If you can rent Outland, this game draws heavily on it. To a lesser extent, there's a series of books by Piers Anthony that this game draws from in terms of some of the layout of the architecture and the way that the colony central facilities are laid out, which we'll get into in a little bit here. Okay, so we just left the shuttle. We are basically a new employee of the company, and we're here to be a miner. All the rooms that we're in will always, at the bottom of the description, there will automatically, the obvious exits will be displayed. Now, in some rooms, which we are going to get to today in this stream, some rooms will have hidden exits, and those hidden exits will not be displayed in the list of obvious exits. The hint that the exit exists will be buried somewhere either within the description or items within the room that we can look at. And we're actually going to do a newbie quest today where we're going to be in an area that actually has a hidden exit. Now, we got a new quest automatically, and we can type quests in any room, and it will show us the quests that we have. The quests will be numbered, and the next quest will be number 2, number 3, etc. When you finish a quest, the numbering changes again. So it's just kind of the sequence that you got them. So it'll always show the name of the quest, and then underneath the name of the quest will be the step that you're on. So and you type quests and then the number, and you get detailed information about the step that you need to do. So let's go quests 1. And it gives you the little description. So this kind of draws heavily on MMOs. So in MMOs, you have a journal. This is essentially your quest journal here. Here it says, so there is, let's take a look again. There's a guy in the room here, Magnus, and we can look at him. We can type look at Magnus. We can type EXA for examine, but the easiest way is just go L and then the character or object that you want to look at. And when you look at a character in the game, if it's an NPC or another player, it will tell you the gender that was chosen for that character, the race, and then whatever description was assigned to it. And by the way, we can actually create our own description, which we'll get into at some point. some of the NPC characters that we interact with can interact with them. So we can actually talk to them. In an update I made a few years back, the NPC characters will have equipment. So in the old days, when the game first started, a coder had to consciously decide to give equipment to the NPCs, and 95% of them did not have equipment, or the equipment was out of balance. So now the equipment is automatic, and it's appropriate for the level of the character. So if I go quest one, it says say hello. So say is a social command. We can say whatever we want. Hi, my name is Robo Guy, and the game will init cap the first word that you put. It will not put a period at the end, so if you're anal like I am, you may want to go ahead and put a period on there. And you can, it'll also, if you say, if you put a question mark at the end, then your it'll say you ask. Let's see, how does it do? And also exclamation points also are automatically recognized. So there's a little bit of, it tries to kind of make it just a little bit more of a role-playing experience. So now we're going to say hello. When we have to say something to an NPC, the NPC is smart enough so that it's just checking to see if the statement that it hears contains a particular keyword. So the quest system in Core is based on keywords. So I can say, hello, you are a real jerk, and that'll still trigger the quest. So, or not, it should. I lied. There we go. Okay, so I guess I had to actually say hello this time. But normally, if you have any portion of the statement contains the keyword, then it'll trigger it. I've now advanced the quest. When you advance the quest, it will always say new task received. It names the quest again, and it says, okay, here's the again the topic. And again, if you do it now, now it tells you what to do. So here, this is just teaching us about the built-in emote system. CoreMud has borrowed the emote system from one of the more popular MUD libraries out there. So there are a lot of emotes available. And I can't remember where. There's a whole big, long list of them. I can't remember where I get the list. I'll have to go look that up. But there is in fact a command we can do that will list. There's I want to say there's over 100 emotes available. So so we are going to. It wants us to smile. So here it's just kind of telling us smile, hug, jump, bounce, tickle, give somebody a wedgie. And you can also do an emote, a freeform emote, of anything you want. So I can say emote, is it bangs? So whatever you want it to be, whatever you want to do, everybody, now, when you do an emote like this, only the people in the same room with you are going to see it. So this doesn't go out to the whole server. We will shortly learn about how to communicate across the whole server. We can emotes can be targeted, so we can hug without any argument, or we can say hug and then a person, and if they're in the room with us, then they will actually see a message that says Robo Guy hugs you. I'm gonna go ahead and do what I'm supposed to do, and it says okay. All right, so now we say okay. Type list emote. Here we go. List emote is what lists all of the emotes. And you can see we've got this big list here, and I'm only 6% of the way through the list. So there are a lot of emotes available. What the hell is what's Jackie Chan?
You do all your own stunts. That's awesome. Okay.
All right. So what am I supposed to do? I'm supposed to look at my comm unit, which is in my inventory. Let's stop for a second. What's my inventory? Hip I or inf? And right now, I only have my comm unit in my inventory. That's the only thing I have. By the way, autoload, if you see a star in the autoload, it means this item will save with your character. So the one I log off and log back on, I will still have this item in my inventory. No drop star means exactly what you think it means. It means I can't drop the item. It is bound to me. So there are some items in the game that are deemed crucial, and you can't get rid of them without trying really hard. The commute is what allows game-wide communication. Let's look at it. And we can see here that it has a charge. So Gurks are the unit of energy within Core. You could think of them as, kilowatt hours. Basically, it's stored energy. So when my Gurk charge falls to zero, the battery is dead. Right now, I've got a full battery. Comm list lists the game-wide channels, and this is what I need to do. These are the game-wide channels that are built in by default, and what the quest is asking us to do is it wants us to say the name of the comm channel that is used for question and answers. So that's this guy right here. So we go say QA, and Magus is happy with me. And this statement is true. And when people have never seen this game before, if they come from other MUDs, they can be very overwhelmed at the beginning until they kind of figure out all the little custom commands that we have. So now it wants us to move, and all of the movement to go to from room to room. So there's a north exit, and the official command for that is go north, but we can just type N for north. So basically all the 8 directions of the compass has a little one or two letter abbreviation for each one, N, S, S, W, etc. Okay, now it wants me to, now I'm in the starport hallway. It tells me now that there's 3 exits, and it wants me to report to the customs office. It just so happens that it says that the customs office is to the west. Okay. Now, nothing happened on my quest, so I need to go read it and see what I'm supposed to do. And I have to say go west into the customs office and say reporting in. And there is a customs officer Lolums is present inside the room. He's another NPC character. Okay. So he responds and says, okay, now he's saying that we need to look at the room and look at the posters and look at the posters and say what the company's motive is for being here on Core. So we'll look. Now here's we don't actually down here at the bottom, we don't see posters are listed, but sometimes, and this is why it's careful, it's important to look at the room descriptions carefully, especially when you're in a quest area, because there will be hints about, like I said, about hidden exits and also objects. So for example, it says there's a row of chairs. Well, can I look at the chairs? I can. So there's some things here that I can look at the walls. I can look at the posters. Let's see, can I do that? Yes. And it looks like profit is our motivation. Damn straight, you'll fit in just fine here. Alright, we're cleared for immigration. So now we're going to need to go north and west. After we get out of the hallway, we need to go see the quartermaster. North And sure enough, the western door is the quartermaster's office. Is there a sign here? Nope. Okay. All right, there's the quartermaster. I can look at him if I want. And when you look at a critter, usually you have to specify the lowercase name. Okay. So he's wearing a uniform that's hopelessly wrinkled, and he's smeared with grease stains. Okay. And my dryer is going nuts, so I need to say reporting in. And this is okay. He has given us some money. So we started with 4,000 credits. We should now have 4,500. And we can... Yep. Sure enough. So score is a command that you'll be using a lot. This gives us a lot of information about our character. We've got our stats, got our ranks, which we'll get into in a future stream. We're not going to be able to rank up today. We have no experience points accumulated. It tells us to get to the next level, we need to accumulate 1,000 points. We have 4,500 credits, and we haven't yet picked a work shift, and we're assigned to work in the North Mine. My Wimpy is off. I probably need to turn that on. This basically says I'll try to run out of the room when my hit points fall to 23% or lower. When you're first starting out, it's a good idea to have that turned on, especially if you have a latent connection. This can save your butt if you're experiencing net lag. My hit points, current versus maximum, my stamina points, my role-playing points, which are awarded by other players, and my carrying capacity. So this is simply units of weight. You can think of it as pounds if you want, or if you're in Europe, I guess you could, I don't know, ounces, kilograms, whatever you want it to be. But I'm carrying 20 out of 3,800. The 20 that I have right now is the comm unit that I'm carrying. So the comm unit, tools will have smaller numbers, armor and weapons will have larger numbers. Okay, so let's go back here, upload the details to the quest journal. So let's go check my quests. Okay, and here he's saying, okay, what is he telling us to do? Head 2 east, 1 north, go to the Starport Outfitters. Okay, so he gave me 400 credits. He wants me to buy 2 items. Notice here it says count remaining 2. So he wants me to buy 2 pieces of armor. So let's go ahead, 2 east, 1 south, and we're in a shop. Our shops need shopkeepers. Most of the shops in the game are run by players. When the player owner of the shop is not online, you can still buy from the shop by ringing the bell, and that summons the droid shopkeeper. So now we have the clunky old droid is here. And there he is. His name is Automatic. You don't have to interact with him. He just needs to be present in the room in order for the commands to work. The shop, towards the bottom of the description of the shop, will tell you what the commands are. So we go list, and we order by number. So this is an armor shop. Tells us the menu number, so this is how I'm going to order. Tells me the cost and the armor class. Now, in this game, the higher the armor class, the better. So the crappiest piece of armor you can get is going to have an AC of 1. The quantity says this is how many the shop has in stock. The starport shops will automatically restart every day, so we usually don't have to worry about the starport running out of stock. But for a player-owned shop, players need to restock their own stores. And we could probably get into that in a future stream. So what do I want to do here? Items flagged with a star are not available for my level. So we can see here that the rugged items and the work jeans I can't use because I'm a level 1 newbie. So I will go ahead and anything that says auto, is auto-loading, meaning it will save with your character. So when you're buying armor, you always want to buy auto-loading stuff. So I'm going to go ahead and buy the mining jacket, and that's number 9. So we just go order 9. Okay, my quest updated, and the count has now decreased to 1 remaining. Okay, let's see. I got the jacket. Let's get, I guess we'll get gloves. Number 7. Okay, so now if I look at my inventory, we see that now there's a new section of my inventory that talks about armors. Tells you the either the armor class or the weapon class is appropriate. Now these are droppable, so I can drop these and get rid of them if I want to. If I don't drop them, then they will save with my character and they'll be available when I log in. Alright, it tells us here how to wear our stuff. We can wear the item by just typing wear mining gloves or wear gloves, or you can just wear everything all in one go. Alright, now if we take a look, we see it says it's worn. So this is how we know what it is that we've got. And so now I should have an accumulated total of 2 armor class. I don't recall that it tells us that, what our accumulated armor class is. Yeah, so it doesn't show us, I don't think it shows me the total, so you just have to kind of know. So if you just see what you have worn, add it up, you know, okay, I've got AC2. Alright, so let's take a look at our quests. Alright, now I need to get a weapon. And we need to go east of the armor shop. And we are the duty-free gun shop is to the south. Okay, this one also has a droid. And we've got our, we need to, what do we need to do? I think we need to list guns. Okay. Okay, this one here. Now here it shows us the level. This one here, you have to realize that if I try to buy the number 2, level 2, I won't be able to use it. So, in fact, I think it'll even prevent me. Let me see. It's been a while. Order gun 2. Okay, so here it checks it for us. So it says, all right, you're not eligible, but I can get gun number 1. Okay, and it says, okay, now I need to stock up on ammo. So what do I do there? So here it says, okay, order Lizon. Lizon is the ammunition for our guns. It is liquid energy, and we need to buy 3 more. And I can just copy this to my clipboard and 1 more. Okay, so now I got my Lizon. So if we take a look, we see I have my company sidearm and I have my 4 cartridges. Let's go look at my gun. And I need to refill it. So I need to go ahead and take my Lizon. Alright, right now it's full. Okay. Now, we can go wield all, and it'll go ahead and it will, by default, it'll put it in your right appendage. So depending on what race you are, you're going to have a hand, or you're going to have like a tentacle or a claw. So you can go wield, you know, gun 1 in right hand. But wield all is easy enough. Okay, so it shows this guy here is a weapon class of 6, and it is also an auto load. Okay, so now let's take a look at our quests. It says, okay, I need to go to the pub, and I need to, in fact, this tells us here how to equip our stuff, and also refill gun from time to time. Okay, and when you refill your gun, it will take Lison out of your cartridges. So each cartridge by default will have 500 units of Lison. So it will take what it needs from a cartridge that has some remaining, and then when that guy will run out, then it'll be an empty one and you can recycle it. All right, let's go find the pub. So let's see. Probably going to be over here. All right, the pub is to the south and the clinic is to the east. Now, it's helpful to make a map. When you play a MUD, it's good to buy graph paper and actually keep a little map by hand. In fact, let me see if I can... Yeah, let me see if I can share this other window here. Add window capture. And I'm going to call this guy map. There we go. That's exactly what we want to see. Let me just kind of move this out of the way. Let's do this. Let's get this guy kind of scaled down. Okay. So this is I used a mapping program to make this a little while back. So you want to do this on paper. If you buy or if you download a MUD client, the MUD client will actually it can do this for you. And so whenever you play a MUD, you really need to keep a map like this. So basically you use the little squares, it indicates a room, and then the lines obviously are exits, like this. So right now, I'm inside this room right here. I'm in the pub. So again, this is where I started, and this is so far, as far as I've gotten. Okay, so let's get back to our game here. All right, I'm inside the bar. And again, I can ring a bell, and let's see what I need to do. I need to buy 4 drinks. Okay. Here, the way it's set up is that caffeinated drinks are listed as caffeine, and if you have your color codes enabled, you'll actually see it listed in a different color. So we want alcohol. Alcohol will give us some healing, and I'm going to buy... the cheaper one for now, because the STR stands for strength. The stronger drinks heal more, but they take longer to wear off. So you will you can only drink so much before you're full or you're too drunk to drink anymore. No, you can't throw up and get rid of it. It has to wear off automatically, or it has to wear off over time. In this game, you can. To some degree, you can make the alcohol decrease by drinking caffeine. No, that's not how it works in real life, but that's how it works here in coremud. So let's buy order 2, order... Okay. And now we need to go to the... We need to go to the clinic next door here. Now, it does tell us... we can drink, and we have to specify an argument to the command. So if you just want to drink whatever is available in inventory, just type drink drink. If you're using a MUD client, you can assign an alias, like a hotkey to that, so you don't have to type all that out. And you can also... So if you type alias all by itself, it'll tell you the built-in aliases like look and the directions. And I'm going to make a new one called alias DD drink drink. Okay? So now, since I'm in PuTTY and I don't want to type all that stuff out, I can just type DD and this will be my quick way to drink a drink. Okay? The other thing is that when we drink a drink... it will convert The light pilsner. You can also type, if you have multiple types of drinks, you can actually do it by name. So you can do drink light pilsner, or if you had caffeine, you could drink the name of it. So you can basically tell it which item to drink. Okay, and then it'll convert that item to an empty bottle that you can recycle. All right, let's go to our clinic. And we've got some generous benefit package to learn about here. So let's take a look. So what are we supposed to do? Talk to the doctor. Ask him about the health plan. Let's see if this can figure it out. Okay. So, I have just completed the quest. Everybody, when we see it like this, everybody who's logged on will see this. So, this kind of broadcasts our achievement to the world. and if there's no insurance. So here he's explaining our healing system here. So, you can heal up by drinking a drink. Or you can visit a clinic. The clinic, you can get a blood transfusion, and that'll restore HP. But it costs credits. Also, if you just do nothing, your HP will gradually heal over time, but it is a very slow process. So usually, most people will stock up on drinks, and that's how they do their power level. Also, you can bring in corpses, and you can process them, and it's kind of like Soylent Green. So you can process corpses. You got to bring them in before they decompose. So corpses will decompose over time. And of course, they also will have weight. But when you're first starting out, that's a good way to make money. It can kind of help you afford your drinks. Now, it isn't obvious, but this guy can give us another quest. And he talks from time to time about rats. And I can also look at him. And let's see here. So, this is a feature where sometimes characters, NPC characters will occasionally say things, and they'll just kind of say things at random. That's if they've been programmed to do so. So this guy has been programmed to occasionally mention rats. So you can ask him about rats. And he says, "Yeah, I hate rats. I've got a little job for you." Well, what about the job? So okay, we got a new quest. So now we're gonna do a little bounty hunting, and we go to Shea Park, and it says here, this here's given us a hint that we've got a hidden exit. So let's take a look at our quest log. So now, since we completed Documented Immigrant, that quest went away. We picked up a new quest, and now it's number one. And we have to kill four of what? Rats. We have to kill four rats. So let's go find Shea Park. So I'm inside the clinic. And I'm actually looking at my handy-dandy little map here, because I've been there before. Here is there's an inscription. Okay, and it says, City Library. Okay, so I'm by the City Library. Is that right? This may be wrong. This should say Shea Park, shouldn't it? Okay, and then there's a mine recruiter here, and since I entered his room, I got another quest. So now I've got quest number two. Okay, and he says, "Okay, I got to get a laser drill." Let's ask the recruiter, who is sitting here in the the room with us, about shifts. He says, "Okay, yes, you need to join a mining shift, And we need to... he tells us about the compass command. This is very important. We need to go to... I'm going to do this in a little while. I'm not going to do this right now. Let's see. Let's do compass, though. Okay. This kind of gets back to what I was saying about how we draw upon certain movies and certain books. So the way that the city... We're in the city dome, and it shows us a representation where each dot is a room. And this, and also every room in core is assigned a unique XYZ coordinate. So we have a rule here that when areas are designed, the game is supposed to be completely mappable in a two-dimensional space. And we may have multiple floors, and you know, floor level one, which is in this case the ground floor, is Z0. So there may be, we may have a second level or a third floor that overlaps, so we have to have a different map for each floor. But on the ground floor, Z plane 0 across the entire game, there should not be any overlap whatsoever. So it should be possible for somebody to map out the game, and they won't have to worry about overlap. So we're very careful about that. So as I move, let's just move around a little bit. So if I move south and do compass again, notice that my position has changed. So I was in 1, 2, 3, 4th one here. Now I'm in 1, 2, 3, 4, 5th one. So I'm basically 1, 2, 3, 4. I'm right here, I believe. Okay. So let's now go west. And we are here at, we're at the entrance to Shea Park. And notice that there's no list of exits here. Okay. It says to list. Okay. This is an instanced area. So, there are 20 instances available for this one. Each instance area, the person who made the instance will determine the number. Some areas will only have one instance, some will have five. This one here, it's set up so that everybody who wants to do the newbie quest, they can have their own instance and not have to compete for resources with other players. And it enforces this particular one enforces it. So this one here says you can only enter an instance that's empty so that you're not fighting other players for resources. So all we do here is that we, how do we do this here? I can't remember how to do this. Choose one and type join and then the number. So I'm going to join instance number one, and now I'm inside the instanced area. When you're inside, it's not going to tell you that you're in an instance area. So if I go east to the starport exit, that will take me out of the instance. It'll free it up for somebody else. Here's a mosquito. How do we attack something? We kill it. Okay, now here's the... When we're starting out as a newbie, it will... Combat will seem pretty slow. And I think that there's also some things I need to do with respect to, we've been having problems, ever since our hosting provider changed our server, timed events are seeming to have problems. So I'm actually having to, hit enter here, which is kind of stupid to force it. It's supposed to go every few seconds. It's supposed to have a combat tick, but apparently it's broken. Here, it's telling us the enemy, he'll start out at top shape. Now, here's not telling us the numbers for our enemy. It is telling us the numbers for ourselves. So as I do damage, now he's hurting. He's hitting me a little bit, So there'll be a when you're first starting out, it'll be like tap you innocently. It'll take like, you know, in this case I lost like one hit point. Badly injured. So this here is embarrassing, and I still don't know what to do to fix this in terms of the timer. The timed events are not firing properly. Okay. So I have I've just earned a skill point, and I will, as I, here we go, near death, so he's just about ready to expire. Okay. I did 100% of the damage, so if I were in a multiplayer area, it does keep track of who did the damage, and it awards the experience proportionally. So if I were fighting with a friend, and the friend did 50% of the damage, and I did 50%, then we basically split the experience award 50-50. Okay, so it tells us that now the mosquito has, now that he's been replaced by a corpse, and we've got ore in there. Very cool. All right. Okay, I'm gonna process it just to show you how the clinic works. I'm gonna exit the instance. And let's go back to the clinic. Ring the bell. Okay. When somebody is tending the clinic, you can process a corpse, and you just type process all by itself. And it does empty out the creature's inventory if you didn't do it yourself. And there's ore there. Do I have a satchel? I do have a satchel. Okay, very cool. Okay. The ore satchel stores the ore that we collect. So we'll get into that when we do mining. But from time to time, monsters will have ore as a reward, their loot. Get back in. Now, because I exited the instance and re-entered, it actually gave me a new one. So this guy is still here. So if I wanted to fight him again, I could. so you can kind of go through the first few levels using this little park instance here. Now, there is diminishing returns as you level up. So when I advance, instead of getting 54 points for this guy, I'll start getting less and less until I get zero. Let's take a look at my gun. Okay, it says I have used some of the Lison in the last fight, so every time I fire a shot, it does drain the capacity. I can refill the gun. So the gun is now topped off. And one of my cartridges has been depleted by the same amount. And the first one, I can look at cartridge. Now, if you have multiple items, you can just go and specify the number. Okay, so I'm carrying four cartridges, and it is keeping track of their statistics independently. I'm not going to bother with a mosquito again, so let's go ahead and go inside a little bit further. There's a fountain. Okay, so here's a case of where sometimes when there's items mentioned in the room description, you can look at them and get more information about it. Again, a lot of this is just for flavor, but every now and then there's a hint about a secret secret exit or an item or a command that you can use. And let's go ahead and kill this pigeon. Now, normally, you can see here it's spitting back my hit points and my stamina points. Just doing regular combat will not drain any stamina points. Stamina points are drained by moving around. So when you move from room to room, it will drain your stamina. Okay. You can type info to get a little bit more information. So this will spit out your experience. And here it's saying I'm in combat. And if we had a mud client, the mud client, some of the mud clients will actually give us nice little status meters and stuff so that we can see visually how we're doing here. Okay, now I got a skill point in energy gun. So, in fact, let's take a look at that. So, the level is, of course, my current skill points. The maximum is determined by my player level. So, right now, there's a cap. These things will not be able to go higher than 5 until I level up my character. Okay, let's get that. By the way, does this show my carry? Okay. In this case, not only did I get a corpse, but also there is limb severing in this game. So on occasion, you'll get a limb, and that also can be processed at the clinic before it kind of decomposes. Okay, let's go ahead, kill this now. You'll notice that when we looked at, I'm just scrolling up here. Okay, the mosquito, no coloring. Pigeon, when he was listed in the room, no coloring. Rattlesnake is colored. This is a visual hint that he's a higher level than I am. You can consider and this will give a approximation of basically it's doing comparing your stats and your skills against his. I think this here is mainly comparing stats. Level also comes into the equation. So let's go ahead and let's attack this guy. Okay, got a skill point. Yeah. I don't think anybody's watching my stream. Oh, hey. Somebody actually have people in the I didn't realize this. I have people in the feed. I just brought up the Twitch webpage and shows the people are in here. That's awesome. Okay, somebody in the chat was asking what client am I using. I'm using PuTTY. I'm just using a Telnet client. You can Google PUTTY. It is the very first thing that comes up in the Google search list. It's a free download. It's legally free. It does have the ANSI color capability, which is why I'm using it today. I thought I'd rock it old school today. We will have a subsequent feed where I will use like CMUD, which is probably my favorite one. Yeah, and actually at the very beginning of the stream, and I think I'm recording this stream. Yes, I am recording it, and I'm going to try to make it available online somehow. But at the very beginning of the stream, I showed how I set up PuTTY. I basically took all the default options, and I just told it to use Telnet instead of SSH, because SSH is the default. So I told it to use Telnet. I overrode the port number from 22 to 4000, and boom, lets you right in. So if you can't afford to buy the, you know, whatever, 30 or 40 bucks for a MUD client, PuTTY is it's an okay alternative. And it doesn't have the support for like up arrow to bring up your history, but it does have the copy and paste capability. So you can, you can, you know, double click on text And anything that you have highlighted is on your clipboard. And then you just do a right click and it'll paste whatever you have highlighted. And that's a real nice feature of PuTTY. Okay. I don't need to use my drinks just yet, but let's verify my limb status. Okay. So in coremud there is let's pull up, let me see if I can monitor the screen. Yep, there you go. I'm getting some good suggestions in the Twitch chat here. I could put up a YouTube channel and I could upload this video. Be as boring as heck to watch me play a newbie, but but this is what I'm doing is I'm demonstrating today the built-in quest system, because I'm going to have a subsequent stream where I'm actually going to show on the back end how to actually go and set up a quest like this. So right now I'm working on Rat Slayer quest, and right now I haven't found any rats yet. I'm about to get there. We're about to kill the snake off. Let's see, and I have to, once I'm out of combat here, I'm going to go check my compass and verify where I am on this little map here. Right now I'm in the green section. I'm in the park. And I think I'm either in this room or this room. I'm not sure which one, but I will verify in a minute here. There we go. Okay, so this guy here, he was a level 2 monster rather than level 1. So the one I previously killed gave me around 54 points. This guy here, because I killed something higher than me, it did reward me with more experience points. So now, just getting back to the limb status here. So you type body, it keeps track of whatever limbs that are shown here is based on your race. So since I am playing a cyborg character, my limbs are cyborgy names. And even though my hit points aren't too bad, I'm only down, what, about 16 points. I do have some body damage here. Now this will heal over time, or I can drink a drink. And when you drink alcohol, it immediately will heal as much as it can. So that healed my limb damage. Also, my HP is now at maximum. But I'm a little buzzed. That will negatively impact my combat performance. So there's a trade-off. Yeah, awesome. Yeah, so getting some nice feedback here on the Twitch chat. So... okay, let me pull this back up here. Okay, so now. Fountain. All right. You can see that the west and south walls come together in a corner. They're painted to resemble a desert landscape. Now, if I look at the corner, look at, where am I here? There is a... there's a hint in here. I think it's either this room or one of the other ones, but there's a hint in here about the hidden exit. Okay. Look at the south wall. There we go. The cacti painted on the eastern portion of the south wall almost resemble a doorway. This is a hint that there's actually a southeast exit that's not that visible. So if I go southeast, boom! I am now... oh, by the way, let's get that quartz. I'm now in the hidden area that was not displayed, and this is how I find the rats. So now, if we go to our little map... I am now in this room right here. Okay, so this is one of the reasons why I created this little quest, is to introduce the concept of the hidden rooms. And if you were mapping this out, if you explored the entire starport section, you would discover this gap. You wouldn't see these three rooms on your map because you hadn't found them yet. And that would also be interesting, and it might prompt you to go back and try the exit. So when there are hidden exits, there's nothing preventing you from trying them. So you can try south, west, north, and if it doesn't work, if the exit doesn't exist, it'll tell you that you can't go anywhere. But when I was in this room here and southeast wasn't listed, I was able to go there. And here's our rats. Now, this here, I was rather generous when I made this quest. None of these rats are, none of them will aggro you. So they will sit there. You can pick them off one at a time. So even though there's five rats in here, you can pick them off one at a time, and the other four will just kind of stupidly sit there. In some of the tougher quests in the game, that is not so. There are some monsters that will aggro you, so you enter the room, and based on your charisma, if your charisma is lower than their aggro level, they will attack you immediately as soon as you enter the room. Here I got a bad headache, and this is telling me that my alcohol wore off, so now I am sober. And I can, that basically is a little hint that tells us we're now back at full fighting fit. We are no longer being negatively impacted by the alcohol. So when you're just slightly buzzed like I was earlier, it's not noticeable. If you're really hammered, and the message will change depending on how drunk you are, it will impact your performance. It will take several percentage points off of your two-hit calculation. It doesn't reduce your damage, but it'll reduce your hit percentage chance. So you'll start missing more often if you're really, really drunk. And also, if you look at the monster, when you look at the monster, it'll also give it its health status. So right now, he's got all of his limbs. And he's badly injured, and right now he's not carrying anything. The loot system in the game, the way it works is that there is a random chance that monsters will have loot when you kill them. The loot is not displayed when you look at the monster. The loot is generated upon their death. And it is a... for some of the critters, like in case of, there's a 33% chance where you're going to get ore for killing anything. And then if you kill an NPC type character or a droid or anything that is a sentient race, there is I think it's a 33% chance of additional loot above and beyond the ore. So there's one roll that happens for ore, and then there's a separate roll that happens for items that are dropped by sentient creatures, whether it be, and again, it'd be all the humanoid races and droids, essentially. Also, if you kill anything that's a droid, there is an additional roll that happens where there might be nuts and bolts that are dropped, and those you can take the recycler. Okay, now I killed a rat for the first time, and it awarded me a bonus. So anytime you kill something for the first time, you're always going to get a 100 points bonus. So that is captured automatically, and it is automatically awarded. My quest is updated, and it keeps track of how many I need to do. And so now I have three more rats to go. Okay. Now, what I would recommend is maybe don't pick everything up. Don't pick up all the corpses right now. You might leave them in the room because the corpses will last for a little while. Here I see I'm carrying three corpses. And the reason why I mention this, now corpses, they do not auto-load. So if I quit the game, these go away. They'll drop to the floor. And if I don't get back here to the same room in the same instance, they're gone forever. and I've not yet gotten any decompose messages. So for right now, I can go ahead and I can drop them. Why am I doing that? Because that lowers my weight. So my carry now has dropped from where it was before. So before I was carrying 1,000 units of weight. Now I'm carrying 700. And just to give you a little tip, your carrying capacity, your percentage of how much you have, that does impact your combat performance a little bit. So it's best not to try to be, don't be towards your maximum carrying capacity unless you need to be. So for example, if you have heavy armor and big weapons, then yeah, you're going to be carrying more stuff. But for corpses and such, you might just leave them on the floor so you can see they're here, and we can get them once we're done fighting. Now, I can fight two things simultaneously. So I can initiate combat with rat number one, and I can initiate combat with rat number two. So now I'm fighting two guys simultaneously. However, I wouldn't recommend doing this because each rat, they get an attack round where they attack me, but I fire my weapon one time per round, and I'm fighting whatever my current target is. So it's not like I can shoot my gun at both rats in every round. I'm only able to attack one rat. So right now, I'm doing damage to one rat. The other guy, he's just getting free pop shots on me. So he's doing melee attack. Now, on the plus side, you do get a bump to your defense skill. So when you take hits, over time, it will bump up your defense, and that will help you defend yourself in terms of, I mean, that's kind of a obvious statement, but basically, I'm trying to remember what the defense skill does. The defense skill, I believe it comes into play in terms of the two-hit calculation. So my attack skill is compared against my enemy's defense skill, and then there are some random calculations that happen. And then I think also the weapon type that we're using comes into play. And then when I do damage, if I pass the two-hit roll, then my skill of the gun comes into play, and the gun's stats itself. Now, by the way, how am I doing here? My left shield arm is at 16%. You can see here the body output is sorted high to low in terms of what's damaged. If my shield arm damage gets to 100%, my shield arm comes off. So just as monsters can have their limbs decapitated or severed, my limbs can be severed too. I can drink during combat, so I just took a drink. It significantly healed a lot of my limb damage, so that's going to help me last out this fight a little bit. Terribly injured. Okay, so we're about to have one rat down. 30%. I'm going to drink another drink. I'm not carrying that. Am I out of drinks? Nope, I have two left. Things I'm not carrying that. That's interesting. I wonder why it doesn't like me. I know I've got it. I don't know why I can't drink it. So here we go. Okay. All right. I've killed off a rat. Okay, and the way combat works in core is that when something attacks you, you automatically attack back. So since my active target was killed off, and something else hit me, now I resume combat. Okay. When you're drunk, occasionally you will burp. Okay. I'm back to buzz status. We can see here I am. I'm not doing too great in terms of my health. Okay. And how are we doing here? So the corpses have not yet disintegrated. When the corpses decay, there will be the way that they're listed in the room or in your inventory will change. And there will also be a little message that will come up that basically says, hey, something stinks. That means that the it's a two-phase decay state. There'll be a corpse, and then there will be a decaying corpse, and then it'll disappear. And off the top of my head, I don't recall what the time limit on that is. So corpses are going to last minutes, not hours. So like in I think in under 15 minutes, these corpses will be completely gone. So the one thing that's kind of hard for new players is how slow combat is. So when you first start out, when you're level 1, level 2, level 3, combat takes forever. And I probably need to tweak the formulas to make it a little bit more favorable to for newbies so they can, not rage quit. And again, I got to fix this timer. So for those of you who have joined, the timer for combat is broken right now. The game does kind of wake up if you kind of hit enter or do some other command, then it'll resume the timer. So unfortunately, I'm having to hit enter just to kind of, I'm basically kicking the game driver. There we go. Okay. Okay. Let's go ahead and let's see. Why can't I? There we go. I don't know why I couldn't do it during combat. Okay, so that has helped a little bit. My body is doing a lot better. Now, let's see here. Quests. I gotta kill one more rat. Let's see, what else can I talk about while this atrociously slow combat runs? So we talked about skills, and there is help available for each one. So I believe you can do help attack. It will give you a little... I think the help topics on the skills is not great. Could probably improve the wiki a little bit. But there's a help for each one. Also, there's even help for the kill command itself. So most commands that you can issue will have a help topic associated with it. Towards a little bit earlier in the stream, you saw me turn on my Wimpy to 23%. So if you want to know what Wimpy does, we can do a help on that. And again, this is going to automatically try to flee, and when Wimpy is turned on, it'll basically look at the exits that are the obvious exits that are listed in the room, and it will pick one at random, and it will move you to a randomly selected exit. Now, sometimes that's bad, and so if you are in an area where there's aggressive monsters waiting in an adjacent room, maybe you don't want that random behavior. So there is another command called Wimpy Dir, where you can say, okay, I don't want to Wimpy into the east exit because there's a boss there waiting for me. So instead, I'm going to set you can set your Wimpy Dir to be, south or north or whatever you want it to be. So, okay, cool. So we're just about ready to kill off this rat. And Alec has entered the game. So, all right, slay the queen. Yes, I can hear their screams from here. Isn't it glorious? For now, you know my terrible secret. I used to work at that lab. It was my responsibility to grow the plants and animals for the atrium. Unfortunately, I neglected the DNA lab and spent the bulk of my time in the vegetation lab. And that was my ruin. One of the experiments in the DNA lab ran amok. It started multiplying like crazy. By the time I discovered it, it was too late. And now you know why I have these cybernetic implants, too. Find and kill the rat queen, please. I must be revenged on her. Oh, and be careful. She's tougher than the other rats. Watch your health and your limb status. Here, they're teaching us about the body command that I just mentioned. So, the queen, she is going to hit harder than her little... Let's see if I have any drinks left. Okay. Now, I'm out of drinks. So now I have four empty bottles, which I can... by the way, those do not auto-load, so... when you have empty bottles, you want to recycle them at a pub before you log off. Otherwise, they will drop to the floor, and you'll lose them. Let's also look at my gun. I'm doing okay on Lizon. I'll go ahead and I'll refill it. Just to go ahead and top off. Okay, now, this is what I was talking about earlier. So it's smart enough that it depleted one of the cartridges, the first one we were using, and it still wanted to top off the gun, so now it rolled over to the second cartridge and it took some from that. Now if I look at my inventory, we see we have a depleted Lizon cartridge, and that can be recycled for money. We can take that back to the gun store. Okay. Alright, let's go in. And here is the Rat Queen and two rats. Let's kill the queen and see. Now, by the way, her color is different. She's listed in red. Let's consider her. Okay. She's less strong than I am, but she's more accurate. So her two-hit calculation is probably going to be more favorable. Okay. When you have an elite monster, will be listed in red, and it will say elite mini boss. What this means is that now, not a huge deal when I'm level one. Okay, when I'm level one and I attack an elite, whatever level that thing is, you know, it's probably like a level two or level three monster. It'll stay at that level. However, anything that's an elite, if I'm a higher level character, that elite thing, as soon as I attack it, it will scale up to my level. So we made this capability to kind of add content to the game so that you know, a level 20 or a level 25 character can go through this area, and all the little rats, they will just blow through. They won't get any experience for, and they'll kill them real fast. But then when they attack this queen, the queen is going to scale up, and it's going to give them a more meaningful experience reward. Let's go ahead and try her out. Okay. Unfortunately, her minions did not join into the fight. One of the things that I will get into when I in a future stream, when I go over the builder capabilities, is that you can actually set it up. You can set up a critter so that the critter has allies, and if those allies are present in the room, the allies will join in the fight. So I could have been a real dick when I made this area, and I could have made it so that the two rats that are in the room with her, I could have made it so that they actually joined in the fight, and so you'd be fighting three critters instead of just the one. Oh, that's a good question. Okay, earlier in the stream I talked about the QA channel. The first time you use the channel, it will make you read the rules. You need to read the rules. do not give out quest solutions. That is the number one, really, even though the number one rule is don't be abusive or use profanity excessively. We use profanity a little bit in the game on the channels, but we don't want people dropping F-bombs left and right. Anyway, don't be abusive of other people. Don't talk about quests in terms of giving out solutions over the chat channel. That's bad. We prefer not to advertise other games. I am paying for this server. Everything here is being funded out of my pocket, so I'd really appreciate if you don't advertise other games on the game that I host. And then we type com rule agree. That unlocks the channel for us. And now I can use my channels. All right, so Alec was asking about the paging. So remember I talked about how you can hit enter, hit Q. There is a setting for that. And it's setenv shows our settings. Covered on the screen. Yep. There is a command available that shows our variables. There is a variable that controls the number of lines that appear, and I think it's called, I want to say it's called screen. I'm trying to remember how I, let's see if the help topic talks about it. Here we go. Lines is what you're looking for, Alec. Alec is listening to the stream. So if you go setenv lines, the default is 20. And you can change that to be whatever you want, like setenv lines. I can go 25. And now, now this more will not be displayed until I hit 25 lines. Okay, how am I doing here? 41% on my shield arm. And let's look at the queen. She is terribly injured. Let's see who wins here. Oh, she's near death. I may finish this quest. That's another thing about using putty is that the line wrap is kind of, if something comes from the game, then and you're typing something. So a mud client like CMud or ZMud or Portal, and there's others out there, will give you a separate window that you can type in so that when the game spits back stuff at you, what you're typing doesn't get interrupted, which is a wonderful, wonderful feature when there's a lot of stuff here. Okay, very good. Let's get my, let's turn in my stuff. So let's go ahead. Now I'm going to get all. I'm going to get the corpse. I'm going to get all these corpses because I need to earn some money. Okay. Let's now get out. Oops, that's not where I wanted to be. There we go. Okay, now I've exited the instance. Let's now go back to our clinic. Ring the bell to summon the shopkeeper drawer. Now, if we do, what is it? Process. We just type process. So all these corpses that I'm holding and the limbs. And I think I have to do it one at a time. Yeah, I should probably update the code so that you'll do it all in one go. Hey, Robo guy completed Rat Slayer. That would be me. Because Queen was mentioned and Rat was mentioned, he picked up on that, and I think it was the word Queen he was looking for. Now I could have said Queen and he would have awarded the quest to me, so he gave me credits as a reward, and then If I say queen again, he doesn't want to talk about that anymore because I solved the quest. So I can't redo the quest. I can go back and I can redo that park instance anytime I want to. So I don't recall if that one had a level cap on it or not. I might have put a level cap so that level 30 players can't go in there and wipe the thing out. But let's take a look at what else we can do. So, let's go ahead. I still got a couple limbs here. Let's get rid of those. Okay, so I'm out of limbs. I'm out of corpses. Let's take a look at my my body's in good shape. My health is not at peak. If I want to, I can. What is it here? We can do a transfuse. Hang on, my cat is getting it. My cat. All right. So here I can say I want to transfuse. 10. All right. We'll transfuse 20. Okay. So you got to do at least 20 points, and I'm now actually I've healed up. So the idea here is that you can purchase back depleted hit points by going to a clinic and transfusing if they have spare blood available. And you can help that by bringing in corpses. So when you bring in corpses and limbs, it actually adds to the blood stock that you can think of the clinic as a blood bank. So it will add blood to the inventory of the clinic. So that way, and then also another thing that people can do, if you are low on credits and you're at full health, and if the clinic is not at full capacity on its blood, you can basically sacrifice some of your HP in exchange for credits. And I'm going to kick this cat out of the room. Hang on.
Let's go.
Okay. Sorry for that. Okay, so I'm back here. So this is one way. Here again. Now let's do an emote. Wave at Alec. So that's an example of where you can do emotes targeted at another player. So I did a wave, he did a greet. Let's go now and let's first I need to get some more. Let's go ahead and we're going to also get all of the ore that was on there. And we're going to turn in that ore in just a little bit here. Because now I have another quest to do. I got to do the ore miner, and I need to join a shift. So let's first, though, go into the pub. Oops, Otto is still here. So Automatic is still tending the shop. Okay. Now, this is another reason why it's helpful to use a MUD client or a Telnet client that has coloring, because the word recycle is in bold, and that's a clue that that's actually a command that you can type. So when I recycle, let's take a look at my inventory again. So I've got 4 bottles in my inventory, so I'm going to recycle. And the recycle command is how I want the process command of the clinic to work. It does everything all in one go. So it took 4 bottles out of my inventory, gave me 2 credits for each one, and now I've reduced my inventory a little bit. Now let's also, I need to buy more drinks, so let's order a whole bunch of drinks here. So let's order, okay, we've got a lot of drinks in the shop's inventory, so I'm going to go ahead and get a whole bunch of them. Let's get like 10 of them. I don't remember if I had the ability to... Hey! Alec is now a documented immigrant. So that's the quest that I did earlier in the stream here. So, and again, that's a good introduction of the quest system. Yeah, so this one here doesn't allow us to buy in bulk, so I may want to make that change too. I should probably make note of these things. Okay, so I've got 10 drinks now. Let's get rid of that depleted Lizon cartridge. And let's see if I can remember where to do that. So, Southwest, gun shop, still being tended. And I can recycle my cartridge. And in this case, there is a safeguard in place where shops, the shop owner can set a limit to the inventory. So this way, and this is important for a company-run shop in the Starport right now is really pretty much the only company-run shops in the game. All the other shops are run by players, with the exception of one, which is in a quest area, which I can't talk about. Until you get to around a level 16 or 17. Maybe someday I might do a Twitch on that just for fun. It's probably the favorite quest of all the old players that have been with the game from the beginning. It's one that I wrote in the old system that I'm very proud of. But in any case, that's probably the only other company-run shop that's in the game. So... for the player-run shops, they need to be able to control their inventory. So they have a command where they can set the maximum, in the case of a gun shop, they can set the maximum number of cartridges they will accept from players before they will get this message here. Okay, and I will go ahead and... how close am I to leveling up? Hey, okay, I'm ready to level up. So let's go ahead and do that. Let's level up, and this is another enhancement I'm thinking of making. Right now, in order to advance, you have to go to a specific place, which is called Human Resources, and I'm going to go there now. I'm thinking that the game is going to be changed so that you can advance from any room in the game without having to go to the city. Here we are in the Starport intake. So now on my map, let's pull that up. I think I'm right here, either here or here. Let's see, what room am I in? South and north. So I'm right here at this guy right here. Again, compass is your friend in case you get lost. And let's go to the center of the... there's a manhole. Sewers will be another stream. Everybody hates the sewers. It's a good place to level up, though. Okay. Now, I am in what we affectionately call 000. Remember earlier in the stream, I talked about how every room in the game is given a unique XYZ coordinate, and this room here is the smack dab center of the game. So all coordinates in the room in the... Yes, it is available for download. If you had CMUD or Portal, the images would actually show up automatically. So if I had CMUD or Portal running, when I enter this room, there would be a little window that would pop up, and that the map would actually show. But there are... let me go... I will paste in the chat here. Hang on. Let me go find it. Not that one. I'm just pulling this up in my history here. It's 1 second. Overview. There we go. This is it. Go hit that. That map is what I'm showing in Twitch right now. And I actually made this map using the CMUD tool a few years back. So, okay. Yeah, this one, and also there's actually one for the sewer. We won't be doing sewers today, but... oh, I gotta go look it up. There is a map that I put out on the website that is a template that you can use for the sewers. It doesn't have any of the exits showing, so it doesn't show the lines, but it shows all the boxes. It shows the dome shape, and then you can basically, you know, draw the exit yourself as you go along, and you can actually use that for any of the domes. So I'll have to go look that up. I just don't have it. I don't have the link handy right now. Okay, so let's go to Human Resources. Human Resources is in the southwest southwest quadrant of the dome. And it is down here. This is where we're going. This is the advancement room. So we're basically going to go until we can't go west anymore. And then we go, now we're in the human resources section of the game. And we are now in the training center where we can train up our skills. And here, the training center, skill training, so we can accelerate if we're not at our cap. So for example, melee. I'm not at my cap for melee. So that would be essentially melee is unarmed combat. So if I took my gun off, then I would be fighting with my fists. So if I wanted to accelerate that, I can spend spare hit points to buy the skill. Or if there's another player who has a higher skill level than me, that player can come in here and they can be a trainer, and I can buy, I can pay credits to the company, and then that other player would train me in one rank of the skill. So that's another way to increase your skill levels, other than the natural way, which happens automatically. We had a player who is one of the original players of the game, who was very loyal, very dedicated, but she always questioned that she thought the skills were going too slow, and she thought she wasn't accumulating any points. So I created a command that's named after her. And you can pick any skill and just type Duchy and then the name of the skill. And I'm going to do like Duchy computer interface. I've got 3 out of 5. And it'll give you a little bar, a little status meter that will grow as you accumulate points towards the skill. So every time, let's do it against attacks, since that's one that's easier to understand. Okay, I'm at my max, so right now this doesn't give me any meaningful input. But once I level up, the max is going to go up. Let me level up right now. all right, this is the skill trainer setting where another player can train me. So if I had a higher level player online who is willing to train and to come here, they can be the master, and then I can train up and pay money, and the cost goes up. So as my skill level goes up in a particular skill, then that skill will become progressively more expensive to purchase. Right now, most of my stuff is really cheap, but it'll get more expensive as I grow as a player. All right, let's go find the advancement room. And where am I? Special assignments. This is the special assignments room is the old quest room. So in the old days, when quests had to be written by hand the hard way, right now there's 4 of those quests that have survived all the various rewrites that the game has had. These used to be mandatory. They're now optional. So you no longer have to do these quests here. These quests don't work the same way. Actually, I take it back. Sewer Hunt, we incorporated into the new quest system that I've been demonstrating today. So there is a way I can get my progress tracked in this way for the sewer hunt. I can't remember if Blackout or Scavenger worked that way. Payroll, I think I did move payroll into the new system. Anyway, we don't need to worry about this one today. And so that is I'm here, the quest room. So I need to go north one, west, northwest. And here we go. Okay, this is the advancement room. So just for the stream here, by the way, the way the coordinates work, as you go west, the number gets more and more negative. If you go east, the number becomes positive. On the y-axis is north and south. North is positive, south is negative. I forgot about this. I can't remember which MMO I played. You know, I think it was Lord of the Rings Online. Certain areas of the game can have a cheer. The higher the number, the faster you heal. So there can be positive number is good, and there could be negative numbers like a real bad boss area. I forgot about that. I'll have to make a negative cheer area. Okay. All right, so let's go ahead and advance. Let's take a look at the instructions again. So if you have enough experience, type cost. And it says, okay, you need to have 1,000 experience points available. And you see that in our score. And that is the available experience. So this is experience points that have not been spent. Okay, so I do advance. And it checks everything, and it says, okay, you've passed all the requirements, and everybody in the game sees that I've been promoted. The way it works is that you're given a title. Your title is basically determined by your level. So when Alec levels up from 1 to 2, then he will become a trainee. You can see the numbers. If you prefer to see the numbers instead of the words, you can type finger, and that will give you kind of more of a tabular display where it'll show you the race, the in-game gender, the player level. IC is the in-character chat channel. There's also a real life that's basically for out of character, and of course the QA that we talked about. Ranks we'll get into later. We don't have to worry about that today. Everybody starts out as a rank C in the three, you can think of these as professions, a mercenary, and a technician. We'll get a little into that probably in a future stream. Okay, so it said here that I received a stat bonus point and I can spend it in the stat advancement room, and you definitely want to do that right away. Of course, that saves with your character. But stats are very important in coremud to the performance of your character. So let's go find the stat room. Oh, by the way, before I leave this room, let me do cost again. Was okay. I now need 3,000 experience. Okay. So I need 3,000 available experience. So right now I have 1,534. I have of that 534 is spare. See how that works? So I can use this 534 to train a skill. So I could use this to train up a skill, but then I have to kill more monsters in order to level up. Okay, so this available experience, think of it as a pool of experience points that you can spend on either leveling up your character or training skill points in the skill point training room. And here, by the way, in the score, this is the total number of monsters that I've killed across all playing sessions. So it'll keep track of this. There is an achievement. When this hits a certain number, everybody will see a little message saying, Robo guy has killed 100 monsters, or whatever the case may be. Let's go find the stat training room. Let's pull up my map. Let's see if that is listed anywhere. Skills. Quests. Not quite sure. Since I don't have this guy... here we go. It's this room right here. So Let's get out of the advanced. I guess before I leave this room, there's one other thing I want to talk about. There is a level cap. This has been a topic of some controversy, especially some of the older players. Right now, the level cap is 35. So once you hit level 35, right now it's not possible, except for certain cases. There are ways you can exceed the level cap, but right now that is the cap. And to get from level 1 to level 35 takes quite a bit of time. So you can't just power level your way through in just a few playing sessions. It will take you some time to reach that. And one of the purposes of hosting these streams is I want to show how areas and quests are created, because we need more areas and quests in the game in order to bring the cap up. Because right now there's content in the game for basically level 1 through level 30-35, and then it kind of drops off and there's really nothing for the higher level players to do. So at one time the cap was 60, and right now there's really nothing for those level 60 characters to do. So we set the cap at 35, and that'll be reviewed over time, especially if we get more interest in the game again. Not a whole lot of people playing MUDs these games, but I thought, just hey, why not? Let's have a throwback day and fire up Core. So without any further ado, let's go ahead and go find our stat room. Let's think it is here. Okay, so this is where we can look at stats. So we type cost, and this is okay. Right now, some of my stats are capped, and it's because I had a really good, I guess when I rolled this character, I had a really good roll on a couple of my stats. So my strength and my constitution are already capped, which means until I level up my character, I cannot improve these stats. So we put the stat cap in place in order to make sure there's some limits so that a level 2 character can't just burn points and have a ridiculous stat. We wanted to keep things in balance. So the monsters that you fight in the game are also capped. So when I fight a level 2 monster, level 2 monster is not going to have any more stats than my caps. And it'll probably be, and it's a random calculation as to what the monster has, but the monster, a level 2 monster, will never have more than 19 strength, which is what I have at my cap. Now, I see here that it says bonus point for 3 of my stats, which means I have a bonus point available. I can get a free level up, and I'm going to pick on dexterity, because dexterity is going to really help my 2 hit rolls. In fact, my dexterity kind of sucks. So we're going to improve dexterity. And now when I look at my stats, I have a dexterity of 10. Okay. Now let's go look at the cost again. Okay. Now it doesn't show bonus points. It says, okay, I can spend experience if I want to. So again, going back to our available experience. All right, so I lied early. Not only can you spend available experience on leveling your character or buying skill points, you can also buy stat points if you have the experience. Now, right now, this is way too expensive for me, but don't bother buying charisma. Charisma really only affects monster aggro. Charisma has, other than that, has no impact on how well your character performs in the mines or in combat. So, really, the word of wisdom is dexterity is usually the one you want to focus on, unless you have a really low constitution. Constitution affects your hit point pool. So if you got a bad roll on your constitution, then you might want to buy a couple points in constitution to get your HP up. For every point of constitution, you get so many points of maximum HP. Also, the dexterity will increase your stamina points maximum. And like I said, when you're wielding a gun, it really will have an impact on the two-hit calculation. Strength is more for if you prefer to use a melee weapon, like if you choose to fight with a fist, or you happen to find a melee weapon in the game from a monster, then the strength stat will impact your damage calculation. But the two hit for all weapon types is still calculated by dexterity. So intelligence impacts how quickly you will learn skills. So that's how quickly you acquire duchy points. Okay, so now since I leveled up, my I didn't mean to do that. Didn't mean to resize the window. So now I can get two more points in attack, and I can also get two more points in energy gun now. So now, as we go through here, I'll try to demonstrate that. Okay, well, let's go ahead. Now we're done talking about leveling up for now. Let's get out of human resources, because I hate Dilbert. No, not Dilbert, the cartoon, the HR guy. Some of these NPC characters can be attacked. So as we get a little bit further up, when Jenny changes from yellow to white, that means she's the same level as me. Since she's yellow, it means she's probably gonna be a long fight. So some of these characters that we meet in the city, some of them, like Yosef, he's red. He's an elite guy. Actually, it doesn't say that he's elite. But so he's red, so that means he's much higher in level than me. And he does have some equipment. So he has a weapon, he's got armor, so he's gonna be a tough fight if I were to attack him, so I'm not gonna attack him today. Mission terminal, let's see, let's look at Monzima. I don't want to be attacking him today. He's more accurate than me. He is definitely going to be a tough fight. But look at the terminal in here. Okay. This here, let's quit out of here. What room am I in? I'm in the Office of Records. So I'm in one of these rooms up in here. And this is here where we can list the player-owned shops. So these are all the player-owned shops and the location in the game where you can find them, which we'll get into probably in the next stream. Because I want to talk about, in the next stream, we'll be talking about player-run mines. And that's where we have our builder areas. And that's where I'm going to demonstrate creating an area and creating a quest from scratch, which will be a lot of fun. So I will I'll show that another time. Let's continue working on our quest that we have open here. Okay, so I'm back at 000. I want to talk about the mass transit system. So you notice on my map, you might have noticed that we've got these rooms here on the end that the link kind of goes directly there. And that's because these here are mass transit tubes. So when I go north, I have entered a mass transit tube and I have immediately been transported to this. I was here, now I'm here. And compass also will tell me that. So now I'm at the end of the dome. Now we're going to talk a little bit about the world of Core. So the domes are linked by mass transit tubes. So we're going to go north, because I got to make my way to the north mine. I think that's what my quest tells me to do. You need to go to the north mine, and here it's telling us go straight from the city, straight north from the city center, which is what I'm doing. It says keep using the mass transit tubes and head north until you reach the center of the north mine dome. And then we'll get more. It tells us here about the compass. So I'm going to hit north. Now I'm in another dome. So now I'm in the North Housing Dome. Now I'm in the center. And I got a new quest. So some quests can be triggered by just entering a particular room. And again, we're going to get into that when we have our stream about using the quest building tool. So this particular room, these coordinates, the first time I enter them, it will trigger and give me the core quad quest. And this is a fun little quest you can do solo. In fact, everything in the game you can do solo. This is meant to be played solo. You can play it as a group, but it is meant to be played solo. I'm at the north end of the housing. Now I'm on a mass transit node. Mass transit node. It's a tiny little dome. It basically just links other domes together. It's designed to be a hub. So I'm now going to, from here, I'm going to go into, and I do have somewhere, I have a map that kind of shows the overall game, how the domes link together. It's not as detailed as this, where it doesn't show the individual rooms of the game, but it shows, like, this dome links to this dome links to this dome. I'll have to go find where I have that saved. It's kind of cool. Once you see that, it kind of helps gel the layout of the game. Okay, I'm now in the center of the North Mine. Notice that the sizes of the domes can be controlled by the person who makes the dome. So when I make a dome, I basically say, here's the diameter in terms of number of rooms that the dome has, and then the compass command automatically figures it out. A dome diameter is always going to be an odd number. So it's always, this guy here is what, a diameter of 9. So it's always going to be like, you know, 3, 7, 5, 9, 11, 13, etc. The city dome is the biggest size that you can have. I think it has a diameter of like 21. Something like that. I'd have to go count. 2, 3, 4. Yeah, I think it's 21. So now I've got my updated task. It says, okay, you've reached the North Mine. As you advance in your mining skill, you'll eventually be reassigned to other mines. So every newbie is assigned to the North Mine by default. And then as you level up, eventually you'll be reassigned to the East Mine, and then the South, and then the West. The West Mine being the best one. And then, of course, you can work in any time you want. You can go work in a player's mine. But for the company-run mines, it's more controlled on your level. It's kind of like a role-playing thing. So we go look at the shift schedule. Now, I have softened my position on this. So it used to be center of the North Mine. Where's the schedule? Look at the mining schedule. I have to set my time zone. I live in Central, so I go, there you go. Your time zone can determines what you see when you type the date command. So the date command is expressed in your local time. The only thing that's not in your local time is the year. So do the math, 2666 minus 2016, and that's the number of years difference between the game and real life. Otherwise, it'll flow automatically. So and there's also a day-night cycle outside the safety of the domes, which we'll get to when we talk about player-run mines. We won't be going outside today because it's a dangerous place to be. Also, it talks about the next time that we will change from twilight to night, night to dawn, dawn to daytime. So the day and night will determine how the outside of the domes work, whether or not you can see what you're doing unless you have a flashlight. I have all the shifts are set to run 24/7. The game, when originally designed, was designed to have each shift had a different schedule. So originally, the game was set up so that alpha shift was active during, again, this is on a 24-hour clock, and it says, okay, based on your time zone, this is when active, alpha shift is active, beta, gamma, and delta. So there's these four shifts. And then there was a originally you could only work in the mines during when your shift was on duty, and it was intended to be a role-playing mechanism, so that people would join a shift based on when they play, and that would help them congregate with other players who happen to be in the same playing time. So when the game was at its peak, we had 20, 30 people on simultaneously. You know, we'd have, Alpha Shift. When Alpha Shift came on duty, then all the Alpha players would go to the North Mine or the East Mine or whatever mine they were assigned to. They'd all work together. And it was kind of cool. There's a little competition between the shifts. However, that became a little problematic for some of our European and Asia Pacific players, where their schedules just didn't quite work out unless they were on Gamma. Gamma seemed to work out really well for those guys. But in any case, if you happen to log on, let's say, 11 o'clock in the morning, Central Time, and your shift wasn't on duty, you'd have to wait an hour before you could role play being in the mines. So right now, every shift is 24/7, so it's more of just a pure role playing as to which shift you're on. And I, at this time, I don't think that's going to change. So I think I'm probably going to leave the shifts 24/7 for the foreseeable future. Now, we have to go join a shift, though. And in order to do that, I need to go find the shift foreman. And I think he is, I want to say he's in the northwest room. Oh, that's the smelter. We'll come back to here later. Actually, do I have anything to be smelted? Yeah, I can smelt this depleted Lison cartridge, and that is how you get rid of garbage, and you get money back. So anything metallic can be thrown into the smelter, and it is immediately destroyed. You cannot, there is no undo, so you can... if you're not wearing it, you could actually smelt your gun if you wanted to. Like, if say you upgrade your gun, you buy a stronger gun, you don't want to use your company sidearm anymore, you could actually smelt it. You get some credits back and to get rid of it. So if you're not a person who likes to hoard inventory and hoard trophies, you can use the smelter. And every mine will have a smelter. And all the smelters are located in every single mine. They're always going to be one northwest in terms of the company-run mines. So the east, south, and west mines all have a smelter, and anybody can use it. You don't have to be assigned to that mine to use it. Let's see, what's northeast? Okay, here we go. Here's the foreman. All right, so this is the guy I was looking for. And this is okay. And also there's because I entered this room triggers a quest, and I have a new quest available. Probably too high for me. Yeah, I probably need to be a few levels higher before I do this. I should probably so the quest tool that the builders use, it does give us the ability to specify a intended level of the quest. This one probably needs to be updated to show that. Okay, so we look at the foreman. Now, when somebody has an apostrophe in their name, you don't have to type it. Okay, and then let's go take a look at my... Let's see if it's going to tell me what to do. Okay, so it says to look at the schedule. You go to the foreman office. Go. Okay, each shift has their own foreman. So where am I? I'm in the where is it? Let's go look at this guy again. Does it say what his shift is? You know what? It's been so long since I've been to the North Mine. I think we need to... Here we go. I'm in Gamma Shift's apartment. So if I wanted to join the Gamma Shift, I'd talk to this guy. Here's the Alpha Shift. I'll join Alpha Shift. So I look at the foreman. I say, hire me. And now I am a member of the Alpha Shift. And if I look at my score, it tells me that. It also tells me I'm assigned to the North Mine. Okay, there's also a quartermaster here. Okay, and I need to ask him for my equipment because right now I've got a satchel, but I don't have a drill. Without a drill, I'm not going to be able to be very productive in the mine. And let's see if the quest tractor tells me to do that. It says, okay. Says, some creatures carry ore. I talked about this. But, you know, killing creatures for ore is very slow. My task right now is I need to obtain 50 units of ore in order to complete this quest. I did get the ore and then clock out. It says here, descend into the North Mine, locate a mine shaft, and use the drill ore command, and then return to the shift foreman and say clocking out. Or if there's another player who, I'll probably get into this when I talk about player-run mines. Players can actually be foreman also, so you don't have to go back to the office. You can actually, if there's a player in the same room with you who is a foreman, he can clock you out, and that'll empty your satchel and you get credits. Hey, don't forget to get a laser drill. Say, equip me to the quartermaster. So let's do that right now. Okay, so he gave me a few things. So he gave me a drill, he gave me a cloak, and he saw that I was carrying a satchel, so he didn't give me another satchel. Again, the satchel is a no-drop item. You never want to lose your satchel. And now I got my laser drill. It has a power supply, so our drill can run out of power. Once we run out of power, we'll need to recharge it with a power cell, and we're going to have to find a refinery shop that sells those things. As a newbie, I can actually use the newbie supply terminal, so let me use that right now before I forget. And inside the foreman's office, I can also see who is on duty, and right now, again, 24/7, all shifts are on duty. Okay, so now, southwest... we go look at the miner service station. Alright. This is available for newbies. So, again, the player-run economy is more geared for non-newbie characters, but for newbies, you know, it's kind of painful to send a newbie out to go find a player-run shop when they're brand new to the game. So the station here, which is located in the center of the North Mine, will give us some items that we can buy. And we want to take advantage of that. So we're going to go ahead and we're going to buy a power cell. We're going to buy several of them because I'm going to go through these like candy. How many do I have? How much money do I have? Okay. We'll get like 4 power cells. Go look at it. Okay. We can see here it's got 1,200 Gurks. Or I'm sorry. I lied. 250 Gurks, and I can recharge this power cell 1,200 times before it's no longer rechargeable. So just like batteries, rechargeable batteries in real life, there is a useful lifetime. Power cells, they are an auto-load item, so they will save. Not only does the item itself save, but also its stats. So each item, each power cell that I bought, independently keep track of its remaining charge and the number of charges, recharges that are possible. Okay. Sorry, taking a little sip of drink here. The other thing I want to get, look at the station. We don't sell filters here, do we? Yeah, okay. Yeah, and there's also a newbie discount, which a lot of shops have, by the way. So shop owners can set a newbie discount percent where the newbies can get, like, you know, 10% off buying items, which is nice. And it's up to the shop owner as to what to set that to. There's a cap, so they can't set it to, like, 100%, but they can set it, you know, 10, 15, whatever. Okay. This says power cell could be recharged up to 5 times, so I guess I'll have to play around with this. It's been a while since this text has been updated, so we'll see. Alrighty. I'd kind of like to get a mask, a filter, but looks like the station doesn't sell them. So let me open up my notes here. Let's add mine filter to North Mine. I'm going to go ahead and add that because that's kind of a little annoyance. We'll get into that. We'll see that in just a little bit here. All right, let's go into the mine. So to go into the mine, we go down from center of the mine. And each room within the mine is going to be is going to have a number. The number will change when the game reloads. This is actually the unique object number within the world. We are now inside a virtual environment. So whereas the rest of the game that we've been in, all of these rooms that we've been in have been written. Each room is its own file on the server. But once we get inside the mine, no longer is there one file per room. It's kind of like saved as a database entry, if you will. So this is all kind of like generated on the fly, if you will. This is not procedurally generated. The players actually determine the shape. Shaft status shows the layout of the mine, and it shows basically a 9x9 grid, and it's centered on me. And if we see O is a room that's depleted, and a pound means there's something available. So let's go to a pound room. And players basically can determine the layout of the mine. So, for example, right here, so there's a dot, right? Right here where my cursor is, these dots are mine shafts that don't yet exist. Okay, so it's basically, you can think of it as solid rock. Let's look at my drill. So if I want to, I can actually open up that room. So for right now, I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to drill right here in this room. And this room may not have much ore. Now there is a timer. Again, this one I may have to, the way the timer works is there's, I want to say it's about every 60 seconds or so, the timer should wake up and say that I'm done drilling. Now, if I move out of this room, that interrupts the action. So I can do any other command I want. I can look at my score, I can do whatever, and then here we go. I've extracted some ore. If we go look at my satchel, now some additional things have gone on here. I'm going to drill ore again, and then the next time I get a message, I'm going to look at my satchel again, and we're going to see that basically every time I drill, the ore that I collect goes inside of my ore satchel. The ore satchel is an auto-loading item, and the contents of the satchel also auto-load, meaning if I log out, log back in, I haven't lost any of my ore. Now, anytime I loot a monster and the monster is carrying ore as loot, that ore automatically goes into my satchel, provided that my satchel has not exceeded its capacity. So when you start out with a newbie satchel, your newbie satchel can basically has a capacity of 500 units of ore. And so basically just across everything. certain ores are more valuable in terms of credits than others. So when I finish drilling, all right, so let's look at my satchel again. Okay, so we can see I went from 469 capacity down to 451. So do the math, and you can see based on my current skill, which is called mining, okay, right now I have a skill level of 3, and you can see that the status bar is updated. So the X's, obviously, that's my progress to completion. So when all the X's get over to the far right, then I'll go from level 3 to level 4. Now, one thing to point out about mining. It's very tempting to set up a trigger. It's called a trigger in a mud client, where as soon as you see your name, extract some ore to immediately issue the drill ore command. Don't do that. So we frown on people running bots to run their character. So there is actually logic built into the game that will detect that. So if you are running a trigger, the game will catch you doing it. And if you're not attending the keyboard, if you're not at the keyboard, if you're off doing something else, and you're thinking, I'll let my mud client mine for me, you'll be in for a rude surprise. So the game will, after so many, I won't go into the math on how it works and the logic, but essentially, this is where my despicable evil nature kind of kicks in. The game will create a cave-in event, and you will die. So there's a warning. So if you're actually at the keyboard and you're paying attention to what's going on, you'll see it happening, and you'll be able to get out in time, and you won't... see, by the way, see here, so it knows that you're already drilling. If we go look at our drill, we now have consumed some of our power. We can recharge it if we want to. And now our drill is full charge. And if we look at our power cell, now the power shell looks like we really haven't... so I have multiple power cells on me. Oh, here we go. So here we go. This guy here, so apparently it picked power cell 2. And now it's at 94%, so let's have to, all right. Now, again, to complete this quest, I just have to get 50 units of ore in my satchel, and then I have to check out. So again, let's take a look at that. So we go quests. So what does it tell us to do? It says get at least 50 units of ore, and then go back to the foreman on the ground level, the same guy that I said, hey, hire me, and you say clocking out. And that will empty my satchel, and it will pay me credits. However, I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to drill a little bit more because I need money, because I want to upgrade my gun. So there is a, now that I'm level 2, there is a level 2 gun available for me in the Starport gun shop, so I'm going to go buy that. And I will do a little bit better in combat, because that's probably the next thing I'm going to do. Now, I will tell you, this was not possible in the original version of the game, but in the current version of the game, you can actually level up your character doing nothing but mining, if you wanted to. Now, it's going to be slow, but how it works is that as you increase your mining skill, your mining skill is determines how much ore you get for every tick. All right. So right now, my satchel is filling up pretty slowly. I'm getting 12, 14 pieces of ore for every tick, for every minute. That's because I'm a newbie and my mining skill is very low. Now, if I were to log on as like my level 30 character in mine, I will fill up my satchel in about 5 to 8 minutes, and then I can go turn it in, come back for more, and that's a really good way of earning money. In fact, at higher levels, mining is your primary source of income. As it should be, because we're on Core Mud. We are working for the company. The company are greedy bastards, and we're their not slave labor. We're not indentured servants, but we are working in the company mine, and we're living in company housing, buying from the company store. They take their cut. We get a little bit. Again, there was a little bit of George Orwell, 1980 kind of. Is that 1980? I can't remember the name of the Orwell. A little bit of George Orwell influence in the game in terms of like Animal Farm in particular, and to a lesser extent, I think it was like 1980, in terms of the intent of the game was that as you get to know the company, it's not this a nice warm fuzzy. Obviously they're capitalists, but they're more like a crony capitalist company. So, and there is no competition. There's no other mining companies on this planet. So the company is the only game in town. And the reason why 1984, thank you, Alec. 1984, yes. So the surveillance state, So there's a little bit of that is kind of peppered in. You find little references here and there as you go through the game. And if you're looking carefully at the descriptions of the rooms and the NPCs and some of the things in the quest, you get a sense that there's a little bit of an oppression, oppressive nature going on. The original version of the game that came out, so this Core Mud is, you can think of Core Mud as version 2.0 of Core. The first version that came out was actually about 50 years in the future of this game's timeline, of Core 2.0's timeline. So in the original version of the game, it followed the Animal Farm, George Orwell Animal Farm kind of storyline, where the company was basically overthrown by a workers' revolt. So all of the miners and the technicians and the mercs, they all banded together. That was a whole backstory to the game. So when you created a character in the Core 1.0, back then it was called Core 2696. So in Core 2696, the first year was 2696. The year that version of Core came out was the year 1996. So in 1996, Core 2696 came out. And at that, the backstory for that game was that the revolt had already happened, and the leaders of the colony were the leaders of the revolt. So the people that kind of led the workers, they were kind of like what, current events, Fidel Castro, right? Just died just a couple days ago. He was this revolutionary, whatever, but then once the revolution completed, he took power. Same thing with Animal Farm, same thing with a lot of communist regimes in real life. That was the backstory to Core 2696, was that the leaders of the rebellion seized power after the company was evicted from Core, so to speak. So there was a violent revolution. They won, and then they seized power, and so all of the minor workers and so on were now subjects of these people who called themselves citizens, and that gets into the Piers Anthony book series that had that concept. Let's see how we're doing on our satchel. Okay, so that was the original version of the game, and then some years later I did a reboot. So I did a reboot of the game. Hey, Soylent Green. I forgot about that. We'll have to do that quest. Soylent Green is relates to the clinic. So I think it's processing a certain number of corpses. I don't recall exactly what you had to do, but basically the purpose of that quest is to teach you about how the clinic the clinic system works. So anyway, so that was Core 2696 was the original version of Core. And then there were some design problems with the game. And so I felt that we needed to scrap some things, redo some things better. Also, there were some real design problems with the game in terms of the layout of the world. We had kind of earlier in this Twitch stream, I talked about how we are very careful in this version of Core to not have areas overlap. So the game is completely mappable on graph paper. Not so in Core 2696. There was overlap, there was inconsistency, there was different time periods and styles. It was kind of the Wild West, where basically anybody who was a area builder could do whatever they wanted. And so it got kind of weird. So we did a reboot of the game. We basically created a brand new game, ported over the code, but all the areas were rewritten from scratch, which is what you're playing now. So this version of Core is the rebooted version of it. I set the clock back 50 years to where the company is still in control. And the idea was that maybe some point along the line I could actually introduce the rebellion aspects and maybe have even players be able to experience that and play through it and participate. If they haven't pulled the trigger on that, implementing that story arc would be huge. And I'd probably have to have an alternate version. Like, I probably have to make it so that when newbies join the game, they're still in the company version of it, and then they play through and they're eventually able to enter the citizen-controlled version of it. I haven't quite figured out how to make that consistent, or even if I want to go down that path. But so that's where we are right now. So right now, the company is in control of this world. There are some elements of the company does have some antagonists here on the planet Core. There is an alien species that has landed. They're called the Odra. And there is actually an area that I have. I need to kind of dust it off a little bit, but there is an Odra mothership that I actually have available that I wanted to. That'll probably be my next major quest. Let's see, what else to talk about this storyline? The outside of the planet. So right now in this version of Core, there is no space travel other than the backstory of how you got here. So you came here on a shuttle. Right now the game takes place on the planet's surface and under the surface. Of course, the mines are below ground. The compass command does not work in the mines because the mines do not adhere to a dome shape. So the mines are completely free form. So again, the mine is probably the only area of the game that really can't really be mapped. I guess the lower level of the mines could, in theory, I've got the mines really separated far from each other. In theory, it could be possible for the mine maps to overlap if the players just went absolutely crazy and made, you know, the mines go hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of rooms. So this shape that you see here, players did this. So any player can come along and they could start carving out another corridor in here. So it's completely up to the players as to the layout of the mines. So that one is in the player's hand, and I don't, you know, I'm kind of hands off on that. And then the same is true with the player run mines. So when a player purchases their own mine for their own what's called a PMD, personal mining dome, they also can control the shape of the mining shafts, and they can actually turn on or off whether or not other players can impact the shape. So they can keep control over it, or they can make it the Wild West. But outside of the safety of the domes, you need an environment suit. The atmosphere of Core on the planet's surface is toxic to all playable races. all playable races will die within just a few minutes of walking the surface. There is the atmosphere is not breathable, so you will suffer damage from breathing the atmosphere. It's periodic damage. It'll happen every few seconds. And also, the temperature is below freezing, so you will also take damage for temperature, low temperature. So if you don't have an environment suit, which you can purchase from a shop, environment suit will give you breathable air and will give you warmth. You can also have oxygen canisters to bring with you, and power cells to bring with you. The power cells will sustain the warmth, and the oxygen canisters will make sure you have air to breathe, because when that runs out, you're in trouble. The surface of the planet is very large, and that'll probably be a topic for another stream someday. Let's take a look at our stats. Let's go ahead and I'm going to go ahead and turn this in. Yeah, I just did a straight shot. Okay, so we go back to my foreman. So I'm back here in the alpha shift. I say clocking out. Okay, I completed the quest. I got experience. So here, you get experience for mining. So when you clock out, you get experience. And then also for completing a quest, I got bonus experience. So there's all kinds of little rewards. So it is possible for you, like I said, to level up completely just from mining, but it's combat is going to be faster. But some players over the years have expressed a desire to have non-combat ways of leveling up. So an experience point gain was added to mining to make that possible. And then we can also see we have our credit reward. I'm going to go ahead and close out this stream by I'm going to upgrade my weapon. Now, when you go fast like this, you can go fast through the mass transit tubes. So when you use these transit tubes that connect the domes and also go from the the north to the center and so on, that's free in terms of stamina points. But once you get out of the transit tubes and you're now in regular rooms, and there's, I can't recall if I have free movement. There's basically some areas where when you move really fast, it will decrease your stamina points at an exponential rate. And the purpose of that is that some MUD clients allow you to do what's called speed walking, where you can just click on your map and it just takes you there, and it sends commands as fast as the internet will accept them. With only a few people online, that's not a big deal, but it can overwhelm the server process that is running the game if people are speed walking. So we put the stamina drain on there so that it kind of forces you to slow down a little bit. It really wants us to be issuing our commands manually, or at least with a pause, so that we're not overwhelming the server. Because when somebody is going, north, 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 west, 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 blah, 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 as fast as they can go, it's actually the game engine is processing all of that stuff for that player before it processes any other players in the queue. So it can potentially, one player could potentially kind of hog the CPU for themselves on the server engine. We don't want that, so we put the pauses in place. So stamina drain, if you see that you're running out of breath, that's why. So just kind of, if you speed walk, put a little delay in there so there's a half a second or 200 milliseconds or 500 milliseconds or something in between each motion, so you're not hitting the server really hard. Okay, list guns. I'm going to get a level 2 gun. So I'm going to get this guy, so I'm going to order number 2. Oops. Order gun 2. Okay? Now, what we do here is that we unwield the colony sidearm, and then we can wield the upgraded colony sidearm in right hand. Now let's get rid of... now here the shop is not going to let me recycle the gun. I can recycle cartridges, but that's it. So what I'll do is now we're going to go back. Remember I talked about the smelter? Let's us get rid of unwanted items. So let's go back to the smelter. Okay. Now, we're going to smelt the colony sidearm because I don't need it anymore. Now, just before I proceed any further, double wielding is possible. So if you have a race that has two limbs, which I do, so I've got a right hand and I've got a left pincer. Okay, my left pincer can accommodate a weapon. The problem is that dual wielding requires the double wielding skill, and until your double wielding skill is considerably high, it's actually detrimental to your combat performance if you try to double wield. You can do it, but you're going to be missing more often than hitting. So I'm going to go ahead and smelt my old one. So I'm going to smelt my colony sidearm. Okay, so I got 194 credits back. And now I'm good to go. Oh, and also I forgot to wear my cloak, except my cloak here is not auto-loading. So this is the cloak that the mining foreman or the quartermaster gave me. So when I log off, I'm going to lose this. Actually, let's go back. And since I have a little bit more money on me, let's go ahead and buy some more armor, because that's really going to help me during combat. In Coremud, your equipment is going to make a difference. The bar. Gun. Where is the... I need the armor shop. Here we go. Here's our armor shop. So yeah, I should be using my own damn map. Okay, ring the bell. And let's review what I have here. So I've got... I got gloves and jacket. Are there any level 2 items here? AC. Actually, here it's not going to necessarily... I think if I try to buy one of these higher level items, it might kick it back at me saying you're not eligible, but let's try. So let's try... I have enough money to buy a complete set of armor. So I'm going to see if I can buy the mesh boots, because those are higher than what I have. And also I'm going to try to get the highest stuff. How much money do I have? The info command, you can pass parameters to it. So if you don't want to do your whole score to get your money, you can just do info money, and that's a neat little shortcut. So I've got 3,500. Okay, so the most expensive things... I would be burning through 1,500 if I were to buy all these items. I'm going to see if I can order it. So I'm going to see if I can get the boots. And I got a newbie. I got a newbie discount. Let's get number 4. Number 5. Okay. Here it's saying... What is it saying here? So here it's basically saying I'm already wearing a body armor. The body armor here is, in this case, it's talking about the mining jacket. So we're going to remove the mining jacket, and then I can wear the mesh jacket, which is a higher AC. Okay, and then the mining jacket that I removed, Now, it is a cloth item. I cannot smelt cloth. So this one I cannot take and throw in the smelter. So this one I'm going to have to probably just throw in the trash. Or if I just drop it on the floor, when the game reboots, it'll go away. So the game reboots every few days. Okie dokie. And let's take a look here at... let's see if I have any other items to purchase. Amy is disconnected. So bye-bye, Amy. Let's see here. We got a cloak. Here I have an auto-loading cloak I can buy, so let's order that. So we're going to remove the light cloak. And we're going to type it correctly. And then I can wear the heavy cloak that's auto-loading, and that is going to help me. Okay. And let's see what else we can do here. What else can we buy that would be beneficial before I log off for the night? So, let's see here. Boots, gloves. Oh, a hat. I need to get a hat. Okay, so let's go ahead and get the hat, which is a number 8. Okay. Okay, and then the next time, how the game works is that when I log off, it's going to save some information about what equipment I have worn, what I had wearing when I logged off. When I log back on, it's going to automatically wear these worn items for me, so I don't have to do this. And then what I'll have to do is I'll just go ahead and I'm going to drop the light cloak, and I'm going to drop the mining jacket. Okay, if somebody else comes into this room and they find them, they can pick them up and they can use them. So these are not bound, so quote-unquote, they're not bound to me, so I can drop them, I can trade them to other players if I want to. In fact, there is a trading capability where you can transfer credits. There's no secure trading window right now, like the MMOs have. It's kind of honor system, so you can give items, and then there's a command to transfer credits. Okay, and let's see, I think that's it. If I were, there is a tail sheath that is for reptilian races, so there is a reptilian race that has a tail, and you can buy a piece of armor for that. And I think that is it. Do I have any pants? Anything protecting my legs? No. Okay, I need to buy pants. Okay, so we'll buy the highest pants that I can afford. Let's see, we got jeans, AC2, and I think that's what I'm going to have to buy. So let's order number 13 here. All right. So now I've got a lot more AC on me than I had previously. Now, the shields command I'll have to get into in another stream, but essentially the way it works is right now is that... your equipment provides obviously an armor class, and again the higher number is better, and then some items will also give a kinetic damage resistance. There's also other types of damage in the game that we haven't really gotten to yet. So far you've only seen me attack enemies that use melee attacks, but there are other enemies that have guns, and they can do kinetic damage on me, or they can do ion damage, and I can actually buy shields or acquire them as loot, and we'll get to that in a future stream. And I could actually install what are called shield generators using this shield installation terminal that's available in the armor shops. So when you fight humanoid enemies, anything that's ascension, like whether it be a droid or any of the ascension races, there's a slight chance that they will drop as loot a shield generator. You can take them here to this shop, to the installation terminal, and install them in your armor, and that'll give you a nice little edge in combat. Okay, well, I'm going to close down this stream for the night. I actually have a flight in the morning, so I got to get up at 3 a.m., and I hate going through airport security. Anyway, I hope you enjoyed a little blast from the past playing a mud. you're interested again, our address on the web is www.coremud.org or simply just coremud.org. Fire up a Telnet client, do coremud.org, port 4000 with regular Telnet mode, not SSH. And you'll get in. You can play for free. There is no microtransactions of any kind. There's no fees whatsoever dangling over your head. This is completely free to play. It has to do with the copyrights that are associated with the game drivers and the MUD libraries that that the MUD came with. So it is actually legally impossible for me to charge a cent for this game. So this is just for fun. Hope you enjoyed, and look forward to seeing you again on Twitch, and I think I might be throwing this up on YouTube in a little while, too. So take care.